Mayors and other political leaders around the state are defying the governor's public health orders, saying to follow them would mean ruin for their communities. The governor, meanwhile, says we could lose hundreds more New Mexicans to COVID-19 and have lasting health impacts for thousands of people if New Mexicans don't take her seriously. That's where the line begins tonight, this odyssey that's been going on this week. I'm joined by line regular and UNM Law School professor Serge Martinez. He may be retired, but he certainly isn't retiring. That's former reporter for the Santa Fe, New Mexican, Steve Terrell. Great to have you back. And joining us as a guest, one of our favorites from Sierra's social digital, Crystal Sierra, the owner and presidente of that company. Now, Crystal, let me start with you. As a political play, what do you make of the defiance we've seen from places? I'm going to pick Roswell first. What are you feeling from Roswell right now?
It is not an easy time to be a politician. There's no doubt about that. Mm-hmm. And I will say that you can already start to hear, at first the tone of the governor's administration was collaboration and working together. Mm-hmm. Now it's a tone of obvious frustration. And if collaboration is not key, it's do as I say. And obviously you can see that, as somebody said in the Albuquerque Journal articles referencing the mayor's, being so defiant on the order, you can tell that it's a very much a Northern New Mexico versus Southern New Mexico type of battle, or reinforcing urban versus countryside, the country, right. Or the rural parts, I should say, of New Mexico. And so, even seeing Clovis, New Mexico, Mayor Mike Morris, a good friend. He's a first-term mayor, and he's seeing challenges of respecting the order. A long-term mayor, Mayor Hull in Rio Rancho. I sit on his economic recovery business task force. He's seeing major challenges, especially since he was the chair of the mayor's council. Obviously, the mayor in Roswell's just completely saying no. And we have to give the mayors a lot of credit because of the fact that they are doing what they can considering what they have to run into. Like Mayor Tim Keller in Albuquerque, obviously doing what he can by not only enforcing it, but also going the extra mile to do advocacy work on washing your hands.
And so that's on right. So forth. That's exactly right.
There really is no easy answer, and it's such a conflict to see what the mayors are possibly doing. But at the end of the day, the mayors are always in a position of, I get elected by my local and municipal government, or I get elected by my local people. Right. I have to serve them, right? And so
let me swing Steve in here real quick. Sorry, Crystal, my fault there. Steve, the idea that a lot of the mayors hung their sort of approach on the fact that they had fewer cases in many of those counties than other parts of the state. But now that a lot of those cases are ticking up in those very counties, does that not prove the governor's point and disprove their point? Or how should they be seeing this if cases are going up in their local areas?
Yeah, if the point is we don't need to abide by this because we're not as bad as Albuquerque or whatever, that's only a matter of time before the virus doesn't care where the county line is or about anything like that. So, I think it's a precarious thing. It's true that mayors are under a lot of pressure, and God, no one likes to see in their favorite restaurant going out of business. Mm-hmm. I was talking to got some takeout from one of my favorite Chinese places here in Santa Fe. And the waitress receptionist, who I've known for many years, she said, I am not happy about the fact that we may be having to reopen soon. What if some guy with COVID blows his nose and I have to pick up his napkin? She was worried about her own safety. And that's one point of view that we know the Restaurant Association has filed lawsuits and stuff. But the workers themselves, could be in danger. And so it's a complex situation because, like I said, no one likes to see their – I'm sick of my own cooking.
I'm eating out of the pan.
I'm not even any business, really.
That's right. Hey, Serge, 18 New Mexico mayors sent a letter to the governor saying, hey, you know, we a little more individual look here instead of a wide brush might be appropriate here. But let me read you something the governor, Michelle Lujan Grisham, wrote in her op-ed in the journal that Dennis Kintai, former legislator here, an FBI agent here in southern New Mexico, responded to. Let me read what the governor said, because it's worth kind of going over this again. Last paragraph. And when we reach the other side of my administration, And when we reach the other side, my administration will take a long, hard look at how the state can ensure that those local officials who have decided they will not protect their constituents amid an unprecedented crisis no longer have the opportunity to fail them. That's an interesting little broadside across the bow, isn't it? It's become very political, hasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly has. And you know, in terms of what a legal authority the governor might have on that front, I think it's obviously it's more of a threat, a semi-empty threat. But in terms of pitting the, you know, the state administration against local mayors, you know, that's not going to be good for anybody, and not good for New Mexico, not good for any of the towns or the state or any of the parties involved.
Well, Serge, let me ask you this: we have some court cases come up. One that we'll have on our YouTube channel next Tuesday. Mm-hmm. That might decide some of this as Republicans battle the governor over her authority to impose fines and restrict businesses. What's your sense of this? Not asking for a prediction, certainly, but what's your sense of the suit in next Tuesday's hearing?
You know, I am. New Mexico has, to, you know, I don't know that anybody who's living can take the blame for this, but by saying we're going to have a part-time legislature and a part-time, you know, of a civilian legislature, we have decided we're going to give lots of authority to the governor. And I think, you know, who can say what's going to happen? But I think the setup we have here is one that in a moment like this, there's going to be a lot of deference paid to the executive, because she is the one who is, you know, in a position and able to be agile and keep and react to things. And so I think the court has not shown a lot of inclination to second guess her thus far. And I think that, you know, because of the setup we have in many states, they'd say, let's ask the legislature. We don't have really that option here. And so my sense is that, you know, the uniquely New Mexican way is going to play out, you know, as we've seen for the last several months, right? No, there's been no inclination from anybody with a, like, well, from the courts to challenge or get in the way of the governor's managing of the situation. And when the legislature was there, they had the opportunity. They came, spent 3 days, and left.
A good point there. I appreciate it. Hey, Chris, we've got about 30 seconds, but I want to get you in here real quick. Is the governor in a potential danger here of being seen as a paper tiger? I ask that because there's a lot of folks out there defying her, but no one's really getting dinged on this, are they?
You know, I don't know. I can't say for sure if whether or not she is being a paper tiger or not, but I think it's kind of like in a position of what's, if she doesn't take action and if she doesn't show her leadership, how true of a leader is she actually for our state? And if anything, I think her leadership is really what we're banking on. And unfortunately, like the Restaurant Association, I'll wrap this up really quickly. Like the Restaurant Association is in a difficult spot because of a lack of transparency. And I think from the government, and, you know, even though the New Mexico Restaurant Association is kind of right, there's a lack of transparency in this decision-making process. Right. I think from the governor's perspective, it's rushed, and it's rushed for good reason because it's a public health crisis. And that's what we always have to remember outside of the politics.
Good point there. We'll have to leave it there. But on that note, as the COVID-19 pandemic rolls over into the next school year, schools are preparing to have kids learning online, as you know, at least until September 8th. This leaves parents scratching their heads, wondering how they're going to both work and make sure their kids are learning. Correspondent Megan Kamrick talked to nurse and mother Bridget Montoya about how her job treating COVID patients and her kids' online education can be at odds.